the universe 2 times older than we think it is?
Is the universe twice as old as we previously thought?
Breaking space news, the universe might be twice as old as we previously estimated.
The universe just dropped and this one's 26.7 billion years old.
Could the universe be 26 billion years old?
So is the universe twice as old as we once thought? A new paper has popped up in the science sphere and it's been getting a lot of attention, especially from the media. It's by Adjunct Professor Rajendra Gupta. Essentially, he's proposing a new model of the universe, aka a cosmological model that describes how the universe began and how it's evolved over time. And this particular model predicts that the universe's age is actually 26.7 billion years old instead of the well-accepted 13.7 billion years old. The motivation for this comes from the fact that the JWST has spotted galaxies really far away at a time when the universe was just a few hundred million years old. And the kicker is that these very distant young galaxies appear much more evolved than expected. So how can these galaxies even exist? Well, that's what scientists, including Rajendra Gupta, are trying to reconcile. In his paper, Gupta essentially compares 6 different cosmological models against different observations we see in the universe. The models are the classic lambda cold dark matter, or lambda CDM model. It describes a universe that is predominantly composed of dark energy and dark matter, which derives its expansion and structure formation. Next is the covarian coupling constant model, or what's referred to as CCC in the paper. This one basically suggests that the fundamental constants of the universe, so the speed of light, Planck's constant, gravitational constant, they're actually not that constant and they vary over time. Then there are 2 tired light models. The traditional tired light model, proposed by Fritz Zwicky in 1929, suggests that as light travels through the universe, it loses energy and redshifts. So this is an alternative explanation to the redshifts we see of galaxies, distant galaxies, without the need of an expanding universe. The second tired light model is just a modified tired light model with an extra parameter. At least that's how I interpreted it. If you read the paper and understood this better than I did, let me know if I've got this wrong. But anyway, tired light has been discredited for a long time now. The last 2 models are hybrid models that combine lambda CDM with tired light and CCC with tired light. Now, for a model to take hold or win as the best model to describe the universe or anything, it has to adhere to 2 requirements. Number 1, the best model must have the least amount of free parameters. So basically, it makes less assumptions. Essentially, it's the most low maintenance model. And number 2, the best model must be able to reconcile all available data that describes the universe, or whatever your model describes. But in this case, the model we're describing is the universe. Take the position of the planets in the sky, for example. Back in the day, around the 1500s, there were 2 competing models. You had the geocentric model, where the Earth is the center of the universe, and the heliocentric model, where the Sun is the center of the universe. Both models had the same number of free parameters, but when Newtonian gravity came along, the number of free parameters dropped drastically, because now the parameters needed to describe the orbit of a planet, like its speed, its distance from the Sun, its position in the night sky, that was all described by one thing: force of gravity. And that's why Newtonian gravity took the lead as the best model at the time. So let's see how these models balance up against the data of the universe. The first test these models face in the paper is against Type 1a supernovae. Type 1a supernovae are a very special type of stellar explosion when a white dwarf star explodes. The way these explosions occur is very characteristic, and so astronomers can use these explosions to measure very vast distances throughout the universe. These supernovae are one of the leading pieces of evidence for the expanding universe that supports the lambda CDM, the currently accepted model of the universe. So naturally, Gupta compares all the models to this data, except for tired light, because that's already been proven not to work with supernovae data. Now, it looks like all the models fit the data really well. But you know what? I'm not that convinced that it's a really exciting result, because all models look pretty much the same in this space. Which isn't a bad thing. Like, this is a good thing to check. In fact, if this wasn't checked and wasn't included in the paper, I would bet the reviewers of the paper would have hit back harshly at this paper. So realistically, at this point of the paper, all the models, except for tired light, are on equal standing. The next test for these models explored by Gupta puts them up against the sizes of distant galaxies, or the angular diameter, angle, and distance of distant galaxies. Now, this is actually a really cool feature of the universe. You know how when an object gets further away, it gets smaller or appears to get smaller, and as you go further and further away, it appears to get smaller and smaller and smaller? Well, it works for a lot of the universe until about redshift 1.5, which is around 9 billion light years away, where that reverses. And as you get further away, as distant objects get further and further away, they actually get bigger. It's wild. Now for how the models compare. And it's all in this plot here. The horizontal axis represents distance getting greater from left to right, and the vertical axis has big-looking things up the top and smaller-looking things down the bottom. The lines show the apparent size of a 10 kiloparsec-sized object, so about the size of the Large Magellanic Cloud, that is predicted by each model at different distances. The blue and red dots with the vertical wings, called error bars, represent real data, real galaxies and their sizes measured with JWST. Now what we're looking for here is what lines match up best with the data. So what lines match up best with the points? Now all of them match really well at short distances. In fact, just like in the first test, all the models are basically the same at short distances. But at larger distances, that's where modified tired light and the CCC plus tired light models seem to fit best. But I'm not convinced, and I had a few questions arise when I was reading this part of the paper. Hold on a second, there's also a large scatter in the low redshift end. Like, what's that about? Why is it not mentioned at all? Actually, on reflection, that could just be because it's due to use of, like, real data, and the models are just based on 10 kiloparsec-sized objects, but then why is only a 10 kiloparsec model included in the plot and not a range? Is this just the best fit for the alternative models? And is that why it's included in the plot? Also, what sizes are these objects that the data points represent? At that point, I went back to reread this part of the paper to see if there were any answers that I may have missed to the questions that have arisen. But I didn't find any answers to my questions. I did, however, find some considerations that Gupta mentions at the end of this section. He notes three considerations. Firstly, we may be missing the edges of distant galaxies because they're too faint to pick up, so they may actually be bigger than we can observe. Second, he hasn't addressed the uncertainties around the processes that potentially drive the growth of these galaxies at this time. And lastly, the redshifts of many of these galaxies haven't been confirmed spectroscopically, and some have actually been confirmed at much lower redshifts. So is this really that big of a result for the CCC plus tired light or modified tired light models? Personally, I don't think so. Okay, the next result that the models are compared to is the one that everyone is talking about, and that is the age of the universe. Let's look at what each model predicts. But before we get into that, let's take a moment to look at both of these plots. Can you find three differences between them? Time's up! Here's what I found. The grey guidelines in this one are beautifully subtle, whereas in this one they're thick and aggressive for some reason. The legend in this one takes up the most beautiful amount of white space, but this one is huge and encroaches on data in the plot. And finally, why are the colours different? Like, Lambda CDM is pink in this one, but it's ogre green in this one for some reason. Look, at least CCC plus tired light is blue in both of them, but that one was initially green in the first plot in the paper. Look, for the love of the plotting gods, keep your figure style consistent and colors consistent in your papers, please. Anyway, back to the science. So what this plot is showing us is the age of the universe predicted by these different models at different redshifts or distances throughout the universe that we see. Now what most people care about is what's on the very left-hand side of the plot, what the age of the universe is right now at redshift zero. The youngest being 13.8 billion years old for Lambda CDM, the currently accepted age of the universe, and the oldest being 26.7 billion years old predicted by CCC plus tired light. Now, what Gupta actually cares about is what's going on around redshift 10 to z equals 10, because that's around the time slash distance that we're finding these impossibly large galaxies. At this point in the universe, according to Gupta's CCC plus tired light hybrid model, the universe was 5.8 billion years old, which gives enough time for these galaxies to evolve to the maturity that we see them. Which is why Gupta concludes, thus the only realistic option is the CCC plus tired light hybrid model, because there is no need to invent new physics for the rapid formation of galaxies. Which is great and all, but I'm still not personally convinced about the angular diameter angle distance argument, and this model hasn't been shown to explain other observations of the universe, such as the cosmic microwave background, Big Bang nucleosynthesis, or the abundance of hydrogen, helium, and lithium in the early universe, and something else called baryonic acoustic oscillations, which I know very little about. So I've reached out to my friend Sophia, who is a cosmologist and astroparticle physicist, to help explain what that is.
In the early universe, matter and light were a dense, hot plasma. In this plasma, little density fluctuations through it caused matter to want to clump together under gravity. Normal matter and light were very tightly coupled together. So when normal matter tried to clump together under gravity, radiation pressure would push it out, and this caused oscillations that created sound waves known as baryonacoustic oscillations. Dark matter is unaffected by light, so it clumped together and formed the seeds for the galaxies we see today. As the universe cooled, matter and light decoupled. Those sound waves left an imprint in the universe and the cosmic microwave background. That imprint, known as the sound horizon, is a cosmic measuring stick that tells us the likely distance between galaxy groups, and that measuring stick today is 500 million light years. Because this cosmic measuring stick expands with the universe, it gives us crucial information about this mysterious stuff that causes the expansion to accelerate, called dark energy.
Thanks, Sophia. You can check out Sophia's content by searching Astro Party Girl on all the socials. So this new hybrid theory, CCC plus tired light, appears to provide a solution to the impossible galaxy problem presented by JWST, finding big evolved galaxies in the very early universe without the need to invent new physics. But it hasn't explained cosmic microwave background, Big Bang nucleosynthesis, baryonic acoustic oscillations, which Gupta acknowledges in the last part of the discussion section of his paper.
But does the media care about this? No, of course not, because it doesn't make a good headline.
So does this new model proposed by Gupta as the only realistic option knock Lambda CDM off the top dog position? No. If Gupta's model ever does take over Lambda CDM as the top spot of the best model, and that's a big if, by the way, it will have to explain much more about the universe to do so. So to answer the initial question, is the universe twice as old as we thought? No.